Random House Audio presents Jawbreaker, the attack on bin Laden and Al-Qaeda, a personal account by the CIA's key field commander, by Gary Berntsen and Ralph Pezzullo. Read by Gary Berntsen. This is an audiobook that the CIA didn't want you to hear. In May 2005, I submitted the manuscript of Jawbreaker to the CIA's Publication Review Board for review. I was told it would take approximately 30 days for them to redact those passages that they felt compromised active agency sources and methods. In working with my co-author, I have been careful not to reveal sensitive material beyond what the CIA had already approved in other books. As an experienced CIA chief of station and one loyal to the agency's mission, I have absolutely no interest in undermining our nation's intelligence effort. But I also believe that freedom of speech is fundamental to all of our liberties, and that a timely and fair review of manuscripts by the agency's Publications Review Board and clandestine service is essential if current and ex-agency employees are to have a relevant voice in our national debate. That same month, May 2005, I decided to retire from CIA's clandestine service after 23 years of service and an additional 4 years in the U.S. military. It had been a privilege to serve in the Directorate of Operations alongside brave men and women who helped me combat Al-Qaeda and other terrorist groups. Despite the fact that the CIA had already approved another book by a retired agency officer about the war in Afghanistan and had briefed authors Steve Cole, Ghost Wars, and Bob Woodward, Bush at War, they held up my manuscript for months. Finally, in mid-July 2005, in what turned out to be the most surreal and frustrating experience of my life, I was forced to file a lawsuit against my former employer. When a federal judge ordered the agency to release the manuscript in late August, they told me I had to redact over 40 pages of material, including the mileage between cities in Afghanistan and the name of CIO officer William Buckley, which has appeared in hundreds of publications since his death. When I asked the agency to restore some of the material that had already appeared in other publications that had been cleared by them, I had to file another injunction in federal court before they would respond. A federal judge will ultimately rule if segments of Jawbreaker that have been blackened out by CIA censors will be added to future editions. For the purpose of this audiobook, I've simply placed the phrase "redaction follows" to mark the passages in question. I am privileged to have served alongside very brave men from the CIA and the U.S. military special operations community while in Afghanistan. As in many past conflicts, many of them were American immigrants, especially Muslim Americans from South Asia and the Middle East, who stepped up and were the most critical component of our intelligence collection effort. Those Muslim Americans reminded me about how special our country is and the liberties we sometimes take for granted. God bless America, and especially those who fight and sacrifice to defend it. Chapter 1, The Attack, 7 August, 1998. I jumped out of bed by the second ring and grabbed the Stew 3 secure telephone from the waist-high dresser. The digital clock read 4:23 a.m. in the dark bedroom of our Reston, Virginia townhouse. My wife Rebecca sat up rubbing her eyes. "Hello," a voice on the other end said. "Gary, it's Dorothy in the watch office." I recognized her voice immediately. Dorothy was an officer assigned to my staff in the CIA's Counterterrorism Center. Our job was to identify and penetrate and disrupt the activities of Islamic Jihad organization, Hezbollah's terrorist arm, and the most deadly organization of its kind up to that time. When we'd established a secure connection, Dorothy continued, 35 minutes ago, the U.S. Embassy in Nairobi was attacked with a large explosive device. 10 minutes later, our embassy in Dar es Salaam was also attacked with an explosive device. I just talked to Chief CTC O'Connell. CTC is the CIA's counterterrorism center. He wants you to come in. Do you have a number on casualties? Did we lose any of our people? I asked. Hearing the word casualties, my wife gasped. There have been large-scale casualties, including some of our people, Dorothy answered. Thanks, I said. I'm on my way in. My watch read 5:05 a.m. as I entered an elevator of the oldest wing of the CIA's three-building complex and hit 5. The crisis center consisted of two large rooms, one packed with communications racks, with radios and multiple workstations to monitor CTC developments around the world. The second room housed a large conference table and chairs. CTC is part of the CIA's Directorate of Operations, the DO. The rest of CIA's employees are organized under three other directorates: Science and Technology, Intelligence, and Administration. Most of them are analysts, scientists, and administrators. The DO is the place that employs clandestine case officers like myself. Back in the mid-90s, the Clinton administration had reduced the number of operations officers by 25%. The DO is responsible for collecting human intelligence and running operations against 6 billion people and many governments around the globe who want to harm the United States. You could say that working for operations is challenging. Most of my closest colleagues are Type A individuals who won't back down from anyone or anything. We accept the fact that we live in a hard world and deal with that reality. It's dangerous work. In the past, I've stopped dozens of bombings and assassinations overseas. I've also hunted down and captured terrorists from various groups. These are CIA successes that were never reported in the news. I felt a jolt of energy as I entered the crisis center. Chief CTC Jeff O'Connell stood in the dimly lit conference room, speaking on a secure phone directly to the White House. Especially at that early hour of the morning, it was an intensely focused group. Ted, my FBI deputy, as well as the top officers in CTC, were already there. News reports from CNN were being projected on the wall behind the head of the table. O'Connell was around 50, with slightly thinning reddish-blonde hair, 5'10" and fit, an excellent Arabist. O'Connell had served with distinction in multiple Middle East posts, fighting Palestinian terrorist groups like Black September and Abu Nidal. O'Connell lowered the sound on CNN so that it played like a silent horror movie on the wall behind him. I watched as shocked, injured people climbed out of the rubble of the U.S. embassies. O'Connell pointed out that initial estimates indicated that casualties were higher in Nairobi than in Dar es Salaam. When he mentioned the name of someone assigned to the U.S. embassy in Kenya found among the confirmed dead, I felt like I'd been kicked in the chest. O'Connell wasted no time. I think all of us probably sense Hezbollah fingerprints on both these bombings, but let's keep an open mind. Then he reviewed the bombing report for the Khobar Towers in Dahran, Saudi Arabia. In 1996, after years of not attacking the U.S., Hezbollah and the Iranian government set off a gigantic bomb in a fuel truck that killed 19 U.S. servicemen and injured 372 people in Dahran, Saudi Arabia. O'Connell looked directly at me. Gary will lead an emergency deployment team, EDT, to Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. Ted will lead a second team to Nairobi. Both of you understand Hezbollah, but I'm going to cover my bets. I'm going to give each of you an officer out of the bin Laden shop in the event bin Laden has decided to go big. The CTC chief of operations gave us our air deployments. I would leave that afternoon on a private jet. Ed would travel with a big contingent of FBI special agents out of Andrews Air Force Base on a U.S. Air Force plane at noon. Ted raised his hand. Given that initial reports indicate larger loss of life and damage in Nairobi, I recommend that Gary lead the Nairobi team. I can serve as his deputy and you can insert someone else into Tanzania. Redaction follows. O'Connell said, "We're going to have a massive deployment of the FBI in Nairobi. Ted, I need you to ensure that we do not get off track with the FBI. Any more questions?" O'Connell dismissed the group. The chief of operations, who was my immediate supervisor, and I waited until the others filed out. The chief of operations, a former Marine and experienced Near East veteran, turned to me and said, "Your assuming command of the EDT team has not been coordinated with the CIA special missions folks. I'll smooth it over. They already have established teams. You'll be layered on top of the existing structure." "Don't worry," I said with a grin. "We'll work like one big happy family." The rest of the morning passed in a flash until noon came. Rebecca, who had taken the day off, met me with a packed bag and drove me to the airport. Our family had spent a good number of years living overseas in places like the Persian Gulf and South Asia. She said, "My mind's on the embassy families in Nairobi and Dar es Salaam and the suffering they're going through. I'm glad you can help," she said, kissing me on the lips. "Be safe." A sleek jet waited on the runway. In addition to McQueen from CIA Special Missions and myself, the emergency deployment team included a communications officer, bomb technician, computer specialist, military specialist assigned to CTC, and the bin Laden intelligence analyst, Donna. The jet zipped across the Atlantic at 600 miles per hour, and after stops to refuel in Scotland and Athens, the jet started to descend. On the ground in Dar es Salaam, I saw nothing. No terminal. Only a single-story building with a few dim lights. As we deplaned, two determined women strode toward us. One was a light-skinned black woman, the other white. The black woman spoke in perfect American English. "Good evening. Welcome to Dar es Salaam. We're from the embassy. Coleman, our chief, is waiting for you at the hotel." During the 30-minute drive into the city, the African-American woman informed us that 10 Tanzanians had died in the bomb attack. Thanks to an embassy staff meeting that was taking place on the opposite side of the building to where the car bomb exploded, there had been no American casualties. Most of the dead were Tanzanian visa applicants and local Tanzanian guards. "We were real lucky," she said. It was 10 p.m., August 9th, when we arrived at the hotel. A 6-foot-tall American with salt and pepper hair stood waiting with a very tall black woman sporting dreadlocks. The pair introduced themselves as Coleman, the CIA chief, and his deputy, Patricia. I'd never met either of them before. "I'm glad you're here," Coleman said. "Thanks," I replied, studying Coleman's face. I knew from experience that people reacted differently to bombings, murder, and unexpected crisis. Coleman seemed intensely angry. Not sad, not doubting, not questioning himself. "That's good," I thought. Coleman said, "I want one thing and one thing only. Find and capture the bastards responsible. I won't shed any tears if they're killed." After dropping off my bag, Patricia drove me to the embassy for a first-hand look. It was dark, but the devastated building and surrounding area were lit with special lights. The bomb had taken a big, savage bite out of the 3-story white structure so that a large piece of one side was missing. In its place, directly to the right of the entrance, where a concrete guardhouse had previously stood, was a deep, smoldering crater. Charred vehicles littered the property. The bomb had blown open the hoods of every vehicle in the embassy parking lot. Behind yards of yellow plastic police tape, Tanzanian soldiers sporting jaunty berets and automatic rifles stood watch. A pretty petite blonde-haired woman with a big camera around her neck appeared behind us. She said she was an American journalist and wanted to enter the embassy to shoot photos. "I don't think so, honey," dreadlock Patricia said. The journalist didn't want to leave, and the Tanzanians didn't want to let me in because they didn't know who I was. Patricia pulled out a radio and called for someone. 2 minutes later, a young officer wearing a baseball cap, khakis, and a t-shirt emerged from the damaged building carrying a shotgun. Patricia explained that I needed to enter and that the blonde needed to go. The young officer turned to the journalist and said, "Get your skinny ass out of here." The journalist didn't move. "The American people have a right to know what happened," she said. He leveled the shotgun at her. I said, "Get the hell out of here, bitch." I entered thinking, these African division people are tough. The journalist wasn't giving up. She stood behind the yellow tape screaming at the Tanzanian guards, "This is no way to treat an American citizen. I'm going to come back." I surveyed the destruction with an analytic eye. Having served as a firefighter in the U.S. Air Force, I was no stranger to the nauseating smell of burnt fuel and human flesh. Before me stood shredded vehicles and a 6-foot-deep crater. I figured it had been produced with several hundred pounds of explosives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.